show in the end. Thanks very much. Yeah, when I joined SA Water, I was surprised to learn that they actually own something like 85,000 hectares of land across the state. And yeah, there was a bit of a gap that I found myself getting involved in, which was the re-veg, as it was called at the time. In those early projects, there wasn't a lot going on as far as native grass sowing. There was more of a prevailing philosophy of, if we build it, they will come. And sometimes that proved to be true. Looking at some 1980s re-veg, there were some understory colonisation happening. Other older projects I looked at were still just dominated with Avenas and even Phalaris many years after being planted. So it did raise a few questions, and it was a little bit confusing for me as to what was going on. Obviously, legacy issues were implicated. And then, of course, we did our own projects and we had more species diversity. But looking back at some of those early projects, I still found myself asking myself some tough questions, like, are we generally restoring a functional ecosystem here for what we've done? Or have we taken a degraded paddock and pushed it to a degraded paddock with some tree and shrubs? And, you know, will they peter out over time and so forth? It probably wasn't until December 2010, reading the, I get this sent to my office all the time, it's the Ecological Management Restoration Journal. And in the 2010 issue, a fellow called Paul Gibson Roy announced to the world his grassy ground covers project. And there's some really inspiring stuff. And there's a few details in his method that really started to make the penny drop for me, I suppose, in terms of bringing together some disparate observations about some of the underlying processes of this restoration business. And I guess hearing him speak actually at one of these past conferences just really galvanised it for me, and I went back with a real determination to get to see native grasses in force come into the restoration practice and just more species diversity in general. And so it has been the past 5 years, I guess. Native grasses and forests have been occupying more and more of my thoughts and filling the sheds of some of our contractors, I've noticed too. As well, there's been a growing body of literature that you can read on it, this sort of stuff, which is calling on the industry for a more holistic approach to restoration beyond the old tree and shrub planting stuff. And we have all these people today, like the topic's grown and grown, and it's really exciting. I'll get into the talk. It's called Native Grasses for Restoration Hipsters. I've got my scarf, actually. I've got some glasses on. In preparing this talk, I was reminded just what a broad topic this can be, and it's really hard to contain the discussion, actually. But I'm going to try and focus on what I think are some key aspects of site analysis that inform project design more than anything. And I'll leave it to Andrew and others to go into some of the practicalities of seed production and site prep and management, among other things. So this is what I'm going to cover, a quick run through some of my case studies. Just to put you in the picture of what it's all about, I will use the P word at some stage, and then I'll dive back into some site analysis that draw out those design considerations, and then go back to the case studies as to explaining the rationale. Okay. I'll start with Clarendon. Some of you are familiar with this project. I'm sorry if you know it already. It's the first project in which we pursued native grasses in any serious way. It's a 160 hectare biodiverse carbon project that morphed into an ecological restoration project. It's located about 30 minutes drive south of Adelaide. It's moderately high rainfall, about 700 mil. Although spring rainfalls have been fairly different lately, but this year's good. It's an undulating site with three large creeks running through it. It's a retired grazing property. The benefits we saw being carbon offsets for SA Water, lasting weed control, we had a lot of legacy weed issues, gully erosion protection, biodiversity enhancement, and there was a real design emphasis on this one that came out of the community consultation about managing fire risk. A key aspect of which was incorporating a whole lot of contour alleyways within the blocks that they wend their way around the hill slopes, and they really have a manifold purpose of providing comprehensive sort of vehicle maintenance access and also breaking up the fuel loads, because rubbish sites, as you know, can get pretty messy as they grow out. And they became, as I'll explain later, a focal point for establishing 12 hectares of native grass sward to get native grass elements to all corners of the project. I'll just give you a quick run through what they look like. April 2012 site prep. September, have we got anything? I'm not sure, let's do some counts. A lot of crossing of fingers and toes. December, some good counts, some little florets and things popping up. By the spring of next year, we knew we had a sward, and by November, we were skipping through the quality grass with the leaves. I'll explain more about how that came to be later. Other projects, oh, there's a bit about the fire fuel load thing. It's quite a marked difference between the rebid block and the alleyway. There's John's part of the track, I'll talk about that later too. Another project which I'll be getting native grasses into is a wetland project, which you might find surprising, but this one's in the lower Onkaparinga. I was keen to see, it's mostly about aquatics, right, but a fair bit of buffer plantings, and I was keen to see native grasses incorporated into the Mallee Box woodland reconstruction, and they're now happily spreading from seed and helping to fill in gaps in the planting design. We also use native grasses extensively to stabilise swale drains. There are only babies in that photo, but that's all filled out. And that one's Chloris d'Anthonia mix in a swale drain. And we also use them for some amenity stuff along an interpretive trail which winds its way up to we collaborated with a contemporary Aboriginal artist, Spark Canoosi, information about the cultural history of the site, and that provides a bit of a visitor experience for all the Noolunga hipsters. They can think about native grasses while they're there. Done some low rainfall stuff as well. This is another abandoned wastewater asset added to Murray Bridge East, much lower rainfall. And native grasses and canopods, this time featured heavily in rehab of this site. Earlier this year, we started to see some germination. There was some planting as well, I'll talk about that later. And with all this rain, it's really going gangbusters. Lots of different native grass species filling in the site, locking it down. And we're really excited about that project. And there's lots of little projects. SA Water has something like 500 of these little metro pump stations scattered around the area. This one at Harndorf, we made a bit of a mess of the surrounding site in upgrading this pump station and used d'Anthonia callosa at a pretty heavy soak rate to get that result there. So, you know, there's a lot of different applications for this work. But I will focus mainly on restoration stuff today. Wayne hinted at like the breadth of the use of these yesterday, and hopefully that gives you a bit of an insight into what I've been up to. Definitely my experience has been, given the right conditions, sowing grasses can be very rewarding. They can also be very frustrating. When things don't go to plan, or when the weeds just slowly take over, or rapidly so. Which brings us to that P word, planning. Who's seen this habitat restoration guideline? Any show of hands? Yeah, we all love it. Anyone use it? Yeah, it's excellent. I think it's excellent. If staters won't recognise it. Their state transition models, facilitated dispersal, adaptive management, seed collection, climate change, it's the bee's knees. You smirks.
Yeah. It's just...
It's just so 2010, right? But all the hipsters now are talking about this thing. This is the Society for Ecological Restoration Australasia. And they've newly minted national standard for ecological restoration. Fresh off the press in March this year. It's great products, low GI, over 3 years, developed by a crack team of ecologists. I'm sure you've downloaded. Who's downloaded it? Someone must have by now, surely. Yeah, a few of you. Yep, excellent. Take a video to parties, do you? Got the T-shirt. Awesome. But what is it? What am I talking about? Well, basically, a whole lot of moffins got together and try to fill a gap in our industry, which is some standards, and maybe they're thinking of the mining sector, but not if you read the fine print. And it identifies the principles underpinning restoration philosophy, methods, steps required, and so on. And it's about trying to improve chances of success. It's got six easy-to-follow principles, starting with looking at reference ecosystems, choosing restoration inputs, goal setting, controversially perhaps, full recovery being the goal, given time. Science practice synergies, that's fairly logical. Social aspects are critical, I very much agree. It has some amazing little charts and graphics, like this lovely rendition of King Inside a Tower, 2012, and their diagrammatic representation of how site condition assessment plays into this. What was I going to say about that? Oh yes, and it has a recovery wheel. Some of you may be in need of that this morning, I'm not sure. But gives you six attributes. You can go out onto your re-veg site and score your, basically, at the end of the day, really, how crap your restoration is looking compared to your reference site. and how far you've got to go. There's lookup tables, 5-star ratings. Yeah, it's a bit daunting. And I totally get that sentiment. Setting your project against a national standard like this can feel a bit like leading with your chin. And a lot of these degraded sites, it's really a leap of faith before you can even start to contemplate end games. And the more intuitive ecologists among us, planning frameworks like this come across a bit like academic pontification when you're the ones out on the coal face, faced with a multitude of more urgent problems. and that was a good day, I'm on a bad day. But I totally get that, and it's easy to freak out sometimes, right? A long day in the sun doing field work, can lead you to that, but we've got to stay positive, people. I guess what I'm saying to you, my fellow hipsters, is that at some point, right, all running around busily getting these projects going, you might just need to sit down, have a nice fair trade coffee, none of that almond milk crap, that's right out. Nice cup of coffee and write a plan. Okay. Don't write it for your boss, don't write it for your grant body, write it for yourself and your sanity and with your work team and go from there. So have a read of Sarah. I'm sure you'll read it tonight. I'm not going to go through a chapter and verse because I'm sure you'll be really thumbing through it tonight. But what I will talk about with the nutrients, the weed seed bank and the species diversity question fits neatly into those first three principles that I've got on the screen there. That being, you know, basing it on around reference ecosystems, doing site analysis, and some goal setting. So I'll just touch on these. Reference sites, we can derive some good starting points by looking at reference sites with these aspects here, species composition, structure, function. And dynamics I've put there, because the reference sites change, so it's really good if you can see them in different seasons, like Wayne was talking about. If you get a fire, great, go and have a look. How does it recover? Is it less intact site? How do the weeds get in there? That's a lot of food for thought. Where do I find a reference site? That's become a problem for me often. In this region, we have some beautiful big remnants, like this one at Mount Bowl. But if your project site happens to be in next farming or cropping land in this region, then the little remnant stringy bark patch at the back there may not be what you ought to be looking for as an appropriate reference ecosystem. And that's because of a little problem they call disproportionate clearance, which is a legacy of our overachieving colonial ancestors hell-bent on agricultural development. At the time of European settlement, grassy woodlands comprised at least half of our region, the AMLR, which is all that blue stuff in that report there. And the Adelaide Basin, the Wollonga Basin, the Barossa Valley, the Eastern Hills, and a lot of the alluvial systems within the hills themselves supported grassy woodlands. Yet today, only 7% remain, so it's no wonder it can be hard to find a decent reference site for a reconstruction project. But it's definitely worth a search. Spending time in reference sites can be very inspiring, not for me at least. And a simple flora survey and a good look at these sites can immediately turn up some starting points for your restoration. Like what type of trees are there, how are they spaced, what's the shrub component, are they grouped in thickets, is that a soil thing, is that a fire thing, what's this green stuff beneath my knees? Go and have a good look at these systems in spring, and they're just a riot of intermixed grasses and forbs and lilies and daisies and orchids. It's just mind-boggling what's in there, and the densities that are in there too. And that's really inspiring. It's also really daunting, because how do we get that happening on our restoration site? But the Sara process can help with breaking down your species composition into strata and functional group diversity. And what it says, and I think it's a really important message for us to think about, is that the organisms themselves help the recovery of the system. Okay. I'll touch on that a bit later on. So in your reference site as well, there's clues you can get for your target community, like paddock trees, alive or dead. Maybe that's a she-oak. Understory relics can point you towards your target communities and your goal setting. If you're desperate, historic paintings like this one of the Barossa Valley can give you a clue on structure. And if you're lucky, someone might have written an account of your district. No, that's not Adrian. That's Otto Tepper with Die Flora von Clarendon, which one of my German wastewater engineers translated for me and gave me lots of clues as to what to plant. And so yeah, reference sites is just key. And then there's the site investigations to work out how to go about it. And that can take the form of detailed flora map production, like this site in Kangarilla, using Bushwrap to characterise each block. And in this site, we found just rank exotic pastures of one type or another. And it really made me think, what's driving that? You know, there's some little native grass bits right off the back, but what's going on here? And was quite nervous about spraying the paddocks and sowing, because the things we did, the nutrient analysis, we went to three reference communities, the Coxland Woodlands, Blair, and Biles, Gottfried, and did soil cores at three depths, which are shown on the screen there, the blue bar being the very top 5 centimetres. And following on from Gibson Roy, focus on plant-available phosphates. And what we see is about 15 parts per million has been the average. And that's been fairly consistent on a lot of sites that I've looked at, as plus or minus for that community. And then we took cores at all of those different bushrat sites, and we got results like this, which immediately throws up some direction for our restoration work. Principally that most of the superphosphate legacy is in the top 5 centimetres, thankfully. Although some paddocks, which happen to be the flatter paddocks, it looks like cultivation has definitely occurred, so we might have to use different tactics there. We also had a look at the weed seed bank situation. We sampled in various locations across the site. We did it in September, which means there'd already been a flush of germination. And we're looking at what's left in the soil cores, and then we grew those in lab conditions and looked at what emerged 10 weeks afterwards. This work was done by Dan DeVow, Jenny Guerin at SA Conservation Centre. What we found is most of the germinants were weeds, most of them were broadleaf weeds, and that the top 5 centimetres had the great majority of those weed material, and much less in the next layer and in the bottom layer. Now, as we heard yesterday, there could be other dormancy things that could be some more hidden surprises there, but that's what came up in ideal lab conditions. And yeah, going through the results, you can see that profile with some paddocks there in the middle showing ones that show nutrient mixing through, also have weed mixing through, so cultivation's definitely. So that's just a bit of a taste for site design considerations, and the way that plays out in these projects is with the Clarendon one, we found similar phosphate legacies across the site, and interestingly, where paddocks had remnant grass, we obviously didn't do any scraping off, because we had native grass, but the soil nutrient levels were low and comparative to reference sites, right? Where we had rank phalaris or really thick avena, there was a signs of disturbance, and there's also elevated phosphates 2 or 3 times the reference size. And so that kind of, whilst we're doing a fire management thing here, if those phosphates were in the top 5 centimetres, so removing them set up conditions comparable to the reference sites, and the grass seems to have responded well. Some of the lessons out of that, we heard a bit today about the sward breaking down, and that hasn't really happened yet, but we didn't do much maintenance last year, and when John Stuff came out to harvest off of these, there were only maybe 1 or 2 hectares out of the 12 that were sort of clean enough for this particular method of harvest, so we have put some work into this year, time slashing of oats and broadleaf sprays. But it did raise the species diversity question for me, in that we only have a handful of grass species used, or was available, and future projects we're using seed production to broaden that out. Particularly interested in several Danthonia species. I mean, there's 13 Danthonias at least in this part of the hill, so I'm curious about that, and as well as the whole C3, C4 thing. The other part of the species diversity question is obviously all the understory, and for that we used patch planting method, where we had 55 of these fenced off room enclosures, and we filled those up with what we thought were the key functional components in hope that as the re-veg takes off, you'll get facilitated dispersal into the rest of the site. And we're learning a lot from that process, and we're able to seed off of those as well, which is exciting. And we've done a bit of forb sowing at pretty meager rates, which demonstrates to me that you can get the seed, Andrew, that definitely works. The two wastewater sites, one was a very public location in Malunga, where you can understand there was more of a reliance on tube stock planting with a bit of sowing. Basically, that site, the both sites use a phytocap over what were very sodic and nutrient-rich soils. Contrast being Noolunga was a lot of tube stock work, whereas Murray Bridge East was a lot of sowing. And I think I know what I'll be doing in future. I mean, this is a classic, like these canopods that we included in the tree shrub planting. You know, they missed the party a bit there, the one that's coming out of the guard, because all the stuff we sowed is already going gangbusters. And a few figures on that, some site survey work that's only sort of 2 or 3 years in. We're getting grass densities out there of average 66 plants per metre. It's sporadic, but you know, if you extrapolate that, that's 1.6 million plants, and a canopod every square metre is another 250,000 plants. So looking at less than 1 cent a plant, if you can jag it, so you know, that's sort of why we're here today, I suppose, to get results like that.
1 minute.
Yeah, I'll finish it with, so this site we didn't scrape off. We were lucky that this didn't have any contamination to it. Physically very fertile, microclimate, but the answer there was just lots of seed, and we basically got a quality grass turf. And I'll leave you with this tantalising image out of KI, where we fenced off 8 hectares. We're waiting for natural regen, but it's only happening where the native grass pastures are. On the right there, all the yuck is regenerating in the native grass, whereas where there's Phalaris being harried in, there's really nothing happening. Diversions as well, as you can see the contrast there. So can, and we have to do other methods outside of that, so can native grasses facilitate the reassembly? This is something I'm interested in. Others may want to comment on. These are the maniacs who I want to acknowledge, who make all that work possible. We have a really exciting bunch of contractors coming through in this industry, and I think a lot of congratulations is for them, the guys on the ground. So thanks for listening.